How you doing, sir?
Doing all right. How you doing?
I'm doing all right. Thank you. What is your name, sir?
Michael.
Michael.
Am I in your way, Louisville?
Michael, how old are you?
35.
When was your crime?
July 2001.
So you would have been?
I was 23.
You were 23. How long you serving?
Life without parole.
How many victims were you?
One.
Gun?
Yep.
Can you tell me what kind or?
38.
Was it your fault, sir?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
No question.
No question.
Was it a moment?
Or no.
Was it ramp up?
My situation is a little different from everybody's here. You know what I'm saying? I can say I didn't grow up in the streets, but I did. You know what I'm saying? I had access to the streets. My family's from the streets. But me, I actually could have, you know, it's like, without going into too much detail and keeping to the prior agreements that you've set with everybody, it's like I started on the right path.
So you had a choice. You made a choice.
Yeah.
To go down the bad path.
Right.
Is what you're trying to say.
Right. I made the choice.
You had that moment where you could have done it. You were young, but you're now saying, I take responsibility in that I made that decision.
Yeah, I made the decision. It wasn't like, you know, at this moment my life wasn't in danger or anything like that. I made a decision to take somebody's life.
What was it over?
It wasn't over anything. It was me. Like I said, it was a lot of things that led up to this point. Okay. Like I said, I was 23. Before that, I've been divorced, been to college, graduated. Like I said, I was somewhat what you would call successful, you know, coming from where most of the guys up here came from. When I lost all of that is when I resorted to the streets.
When you lost all of what?
When I became divorced, lost that part of my family, my life, the job I had and everything. I moved back home to Louisville. I didn't have anything. So the only thing that I knew that I could possibly do at that moment, I tried to work, couldn't support myself, couldn't support my family. The money just wasn't there.
You had child support?
No, I don't have any kids. I don't have any kids.
No,
but I was supporting my mother.
Right, okay.
So I couldn't support my family. So by me not being able to support my family, I felt like less of a man. So the only way I felt like I could support my family was to get involved into the streets. I started selling crack. I started selling weed. I started robbing. I started doing pretty much anything and everything I could to bring money to the household.
Did you think that it would lead to you killing someone? I mean, when you were doing that, when you made that
No,
choice.
I never thought that everything I was doing would lead to me killing someone, but unfortunately, I hadn't mentally prepared myself for that.
So you knew going
that ahead. There was a possibility. Yeah, I mean, I didn't think that I would be able to do it, but I knew that going down that path, there was no telling what would happen.
12 years ago, or almost 12 years ago, how long are you serving life without?
Life without.
You're never getting out.
That's what they say. Right. But as of now, I answer to a higher calling. It's not up to me anymore.
You turned it over to?
I turned my life over to God a long time ago. Plus, I am getting out through this message. My body might be stuck behind these bars and these walls, but my message and my soul can get out every day.
Then, my friend, give your message.
My message is, like I said, can I go off the agreement?
Go ahead on, bro. Keep it 100.
Because I can't really tell my story without doing that, man.
Yeah.
And okay.
Just keep it 100.
My name is Michael Holloway. But a lot of people probably from the city of Louisville will know me as Michael Lockhart. I grew up as a basketball player, went to play at Rich Park High School, graduated in 96. Like I said, I was a success. Went to college, did it all. My life, when I got married, moved to California, lost all of that. My message to the kids is, it doesn't, like I said, like everybody up here, everybody's situation is different. It doesn't have to be a split moment. It is about choices. Each person's situation is different. Mine's, unfortunately for me, when I came to that fork in the road, I chose to go down the wrong path.
You had it all, Michael.
Yeah, I had it all. And unfortunately, because things got hard for me, I chose to make it even worse. And unfortunately, that in my eyes, that's what's wrong with the youth today. When things get hard for the kids nowadays, they want the easy way out. The easy way is to stand on the street corner and sell 10 hours for dope, 20 hours for dope. The easy way is to break in somebody's house and steal this and take it to somebody and sell it. The hard way at that moment is to stay in school, to go to school, if you're still in school.
In your case, you felt the pressure and cracked.
Yeah, I cracked under the, they got that old saying, pressure bust pipes, my pipes busted.
And the person you killed, do you think about that?
Every single day. Not only do I think about that person, the victim in my case was a female. Not only do I think about her, I think about her daughter, her family. Her daughter would not grow up without a mother.
As you look back into the time and you think about all this, does it seem real to you that that guy who did this is you?
No, it doesn't. And that's something that I've come to realize over the years, is that the person that I was, it wasn't really me. I was trying to be somebody I wasn't. And most of the time, when guys get caught up in situations like this, whether it's a split moment, whether it's planned, whatever the situation may be, it's because we're trying to be somebody that we're not deep down inside.
Is it a thing, guys? Help me with this, because I don't live the street. I've covered the street enough. I get it. About you can't be weak, man. They will destroy you on the street if you're weak, right?
I mean, I didn't really care about that.
When I was coming up,
I didn't care about what the streets thought about me or anything.
So it's kind of a personal journey, right?
Yeah, with me, like I said, it was because I could not take care of responsibilities at home, so I felt like less of a man.
So it was a pride thing?
Yeah, with me it was, yeah. I felt like less of a man. I'm from a single family, my mom raised me. My dad was in my life, but my mom raised me.
Can I make a point, we'll widen out on this. I look at you guys, and I listen to each one of you. I listen to what you're telling me. And you, I'm so sorry, Chris, too.
I'm okay.
I look at you, and I've interviewed murderers. Trust me. A lot of them. I don't see you that way. That's not who you are sitting here today. Am I wrong?
I mean, in a way you are, in a way you're not. Technically, we're murderers. Technically, by society standards, everybody in society, everybody that's going to watch this is going to label us as murderers. But who each and every one of us are as an individual may not be that person. That's just a label. That's just like you, you're a newscaster. That's not who you are as a man.
Well, some would see that as a worse name.
I mean, but you know.
in my heart, I'm not a murderer. I wouldn't do it again to, you know, intentionally kill and take somebody's life, because it's not something you should do. I mean, I don't feel like it's right. I mean, but at those times we couldn't make decisions, you know, some of us couldn't make.
What is the answer? We all talk about don't do this, don't do this. You know what it's like out there. They're not making that choice. What's the answer that we need to give them? What is needed to stop this?
I want to say, keep doing something in your life, like stay in school, hobbies, things that occupy your time to keep you not thinking about dwelling on the hard times and the arguments, and you know, those are probably the best things that I was, from my perspective, keep it busy.
I want to piggyback on something that both Michael said, like how Michael made the point that crack was the easy thing, school is the hard thing, and a lot of the young people really believe that, but this is hard. Doing time in here is hard. Having to get your education in prison and find out that you are good at something, but you find that out while you're in prison, that's what's difficult. If we can get them to understand that school is not that difficult, 4 years to finish high school is not a long time. 2 or 4 more years to get a trade or go to college is not a long time. This violence thing is like a disease. It's like a plague. And what's happening is it's happening so prevalent that even the people that are witnessing it, they don't want that to happen to them, and they seem so quick to want to pick up a gun or a knife. And I want to tell them, think through these problems. Your future is your future. It is so valuable. Please don't trick it off on an impulsive decision.
But you all said it's crack, it's money. You got people with poverty.
It's not just that. I mean, you know, it's your surroundings. I mean, you know.
So it's a culture.
No, I'm not going to say it's culture, because this is happening in some of the white neighborhoods too.
But you know, it's chronic. In the African American community on the West Side, it's chronic.
I think the problem is the fact that a lot of people might not want to agree to this. Starts at home. It starts with parents. It starts with teachers. Because, like I said, my situation is different. You know, I have people that backed me. They supported me. Unfortunately, they supported me because they figured I was going to be some type of super basketball star. I was going to be very successful. The problem is we don't have enough people like Mr. Christopher 2X here, and you and other people here, that want to get involved with everyone. They're only wanting to be involved with the people they feel are going to be success stories. They don't want to get involved with the people that's going to make them actually have to work. And maybe if they do get involved with this person and they don't turn out right, oh man, he didn't turn out right, this is going to be bad on me.
But here's what we're talking about. You're speaking about a sickness, right?
It's a disease.
All right, it's a disease, it's a sickness. And I keep coming back to the thing. How are we going to turn them around when
it's not going to change overnight? It's going to take some time. It's going to take some time. Like my brother Michael said right here.
I think you need more programs back in the communities, yeah. Because, you know, when I was a kid, you know, we coming up, we kind of like had, it was like those things is that's something the kids always want to do. They want to play on the football team. They want
to do.
Surely, they want to do that.
We need to keep pushing positivity on the negative and, you know, weed out the negative.
Even if it doesn't seem like it's making on the foot.
Right. More role models, positive role models.
Am I hearing that you guys needed that growing up?
Yeah.
Exactly.
I had it.
How many did you have what Michael had? How many came up without the kind of support you needed?
I needed more support. I can't say, I would be lying if I said I didn't have any, but we need more support.
Right.
And another thing.
Did all of you have a mom and dad in the house?
Not in the house. It was mainly my mom, and then when it wasn't my mom, because she got on drugs, and I went to my grandfather to stay. So a lot of us come from situations to where the home is broken or there's some sort of element, but I wouldn't be keeping it real if I said I didn't have any. But I did want to say something. I think I heard Mr. 2X use the term before, mental first aid, or how, like, if something happens, a violent act happens on the scene, we need people to go to the scene to be able to help these youth process maybe what they saw, if they were like the victim of a crime, or if somebody witnessed a killing, because that could be a way to ward off the disease, to keep it from spreading.
And Chris is going to take over in a second. I'm almost done. But I want to ask, are we ever going to stop this? They're going to look at all of you, they're going to see.
It starts from yourself. Everybody got to, you know, analyze, evaluate your own personal. It all starts from yourself, because we all got the decisions. We all got the decisions, the choices to make the things we've done. And we're going to have to always have tough decisions coming up in life.
But these kids are even worse going through. It's, they've seen more violence. It's worse than even when you were out there. How we speak to them?
One thing I think they need to know that this ain't no fun.
One at a time. Go ahead.
This ain't no fun. Being separated from your family, that's the one thing they need to know. This could wake them up, you know, and it could not. I mean, there's a different catch for everybody. But, you know, this right here, this ain't no fun. This ain't cool. This ain't what it's about. I done had, you know, some of my family members who I thought was my closest family members separate from me, or me separate myself from them since I've been in here.
So
and I've had, and I, no, I get visits, but I'm saying from some of the ones that was the closest, no, I don't get visits from them. And then, like, you know, I've had people who I didn't think was so close to me step up and be more supporting and comforting. But this ain't cool.
Like I was saying, it's everyone is saying that the violence now is worse than it was back then. It's not that it's worse. It's just that people are starting to notice it more now. Trust me, it was worse. It was the same then. It's just now starting to become in the public eye, which unfortunately is a good thing, because now that everyone is starting to take notice, maybe something can finally get done.
Yeah, it finally can make a change.
See, that was
a
problem. You can't think negative about if or... Or is it going to, it's going to change. You know, we gonna rise above it all.
It took years for things to get to where they are right now. People say, oh, it's bad, how it's gonna change. But just like it gradually got worse, it can get better. Might not happen tomorrow, but we've got to speak against the negativity and the violence.
It's gonna change. I believe it's gonna change.
Oh, yeah.
You're not.
Man.
You're out there full.